Welcome to Massenomics, the world's strongest podcast. Find us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at Massenomics. Make sure you go visit Massenomics.com. There you'll find the rest of our powerful content. While you're there, check out our store and buy yourself some of that sweet Massenomics gear.
Yeah. Yeah, you gotta sit right up in your stuff. All right, well, we're good to go.
I'm good.
We're good to go.
We're good. Fresh. All right. Cream fresh.
So, we're here in the Massenomics studio on a crisp November evening.
Not that crisp.
This is the first podcast.
More like a fresh November evening.
First podcast inside Trump's America.
None of us are super political.
Yeah, that's the best part.
So you're welcome. All of you listening, you're welcome. You don't have to hear more.
Yeah, none of us actually give a fuck about that at all.
If you're concerned about that, you could probably head over to Facebook, and I'm sure there's hours worth of
has there been something
material.
Has there been anything on there about it?
I caught a few posts here and there, but I wasn't sure what it would pertain to.
That's a lot of people's moms complaining about things.
They need to take Facebook back away from... they need to... Make Facebook back to, like, just college people. They can take it away from us if they need
make
to.
Make Facebook cool again.
Yeah.
I have a different philosophy about what needs to be done with Snapchat, but I can't say that because my mom listens to this. But we got to take Snapchat back to its original intentions. Well, guys, we're here. This is, what are we, 5-6 days removed from the... I don't know what you guys heard the last 2 weeks on the podcast. I haven't listened to it yet.
We haven't listened to it, and none of us exactly remember.
None of us are. I don't remember much of it.
I mean, I have a vague idea of what happened.
The Massenomics Party Cast is what we've released for the last 2 weeks. So I'm assuming that was really good and not really sad.
Right? Not pathetic.
Like, these guys have a fucking problem. What the hell happened that night? What did we...
Well, what didn't happen that night?
That's a shorter list.
It was a good time. The Massenomics 1 year party, I would say, was a raging success.
It was good.
I don't know what else we could have asked for, really.
We ate a lot and drank a lot, and then it got into a lot of Hammerschlagen and a lot of Tippy Cup. Yep.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And the podcast was going like over in a separate room for like 2 hours there. I think
cameo appearance after cameo.
It was a pretty good vibe in the old depot.
Was there a bunch of famous people there?
All of the Massenomics people that are famous from Instagram were there. You know, Larry and Shane. Shane did his guest posing just like we had on the ticket.
Yeah. We have, if you haven't gone and read the show notes from last week, you absolutely must. We'll have the photo. Photo will be up there with Shane. Somehow can outflex a room of 30 people flexing,
and it's not even comparable.
No, close. There's literally a picture. I counted the people. I can't remember how many are in the picture. If it's like 35, everyone's flexing, and all you still notice is Shane flexing.
it's like the star on the Christmas tree is what I think when I see that.
Yeah,
it's just so much above and beyond everything else.
I don't remember any of that. All I know was when I got up the next morning, I was like, fuck, where's all the podcast equipment?
did you take it home with you?
Yeah. And I was pretty sure I packed it up and I just threw it in a suitcase. And then it didn't come make it into my house. It was in the trunk of the car. My wife drove me home. But, I came downstairs and I was all looking around all frantically and, No suitcase. And I was like, damn it, honey, what'd you do with it? Sure enough, it was just in the trunk. And once I got that figured out, I then got to spend 8 consecutive hours on the floor in my living room complaining. So
I kind of went through the same panic of bringing my camera in and just, oh, it's here, it's locked in, we're good, don't need to worry about it. And then the next morning I woke up and was immediately second-guessing all of my choices with that. And I'm thinking, oh, I really hope Tanner locked that building up because for people that don't know, it is in a very prime time nightlife area of town. A lot
it's
of people
dirty.
Coming.
Yeah. It's dirty.
So I was just like, I could totally see someone walking in there stealing all my camera gear and I'd be in a bad spot then.
I didn't sleep very well that night. So I woke up at about 6:45 and I was like, well, this cleaning has to happen sometime. It's, do I lay here for 2 more hours feeling crappy, or just go suck it up and get to getting? So I went there and started cleaning up at about 6:45, and the smell of the room.
Did it smell like a brewery that someone just abandoned?
It doesn't even make sense that like it could stink of beer that bad, but it was all over.
Because it's a big building too. It's not like we're in some little tiny room party.
This was a train depot that we rented. So like, were people spilling everywhere? I don't.
We were playing tippy cup.
The old tippy cup.
Oh yeah.
And
I know at the time the old drunk brain kicked in. Everyone's like, we'll just put the tablecloths on the floor. Yeah. There won't be a mess, which doesn't make any sense.
No, there's no need. I mean, it would have been easier actually to clean up had the tablecloths just not been there.
Now you had a tablecloth covered in beer that you had to worry about.
if it could have just, I was mopping the floor anyways. It's not like it was saving me.
I remember at the time being like, what a good idea. Like, everyone's so smart here.
I would say this, for as many beers, I carried garbage sack after garbage sack out of beer cans and beer bottles, but for as many beers that got drank, I think just about as many got half drank and left around somewhere in that building. Like that I dumped out probably 100 half empty beers.
That's like rule number one of hosting a party is just get used to the fact that you're going to probably dump as much beer as people drink.
Yeah.
It's a mix, I think, of people just actually don't drink beer and people set them down and just move on and forget about it and grab another one.
Yeah.
I don't know. I brought like 4 beers as soon as we were to start podcast, I was like, well, I don't know how long this is going to be. So I packed like 4 beers, drank them all before our first break, and then don't know what happened after that.
Then things got good, right?
I suppose that's the most, you know, exciting hour of the podcast. I don't know. How did that affect your guys' Monday?
Not that bad. I didn't have a real heavy day, so I was
pretty
good
on Monday. You know, it's Monday is my city league volleyball night, and
did you still win or did you lose? Because
it got canceled, and I missed the memo, so I showed up and didn't have a game. And then at that point, it was too late for me to be concerned about lifting. So
you
I
warmed
just had
up,
a,
got your knee pads.
I
on,
had
your
a total,
high socks.
You know, my spandex was looking top notch, but I had to ended up doing nothing Monday night.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm still kind of hurt, so I didn't really do shit all week. So
from the party, you got hurt?
No. No, I'm still nursing a back thing. I don't know. It's fucking me up psychologically because I'm used to like, okay, well, I'm going to go kick some ass today, and then I do it every day or else I feel like a piece of shit.
Mm-hmm.
So taking like 5 days off is like...
You really feel like a piece
huge
of shit.
Momentum
Man.
Killer.
Yeah. I'm going to turn into a 110-pound weakling pretty soon here.
Yeah, I know. I've been weighing myself every day. Like,
just watching
on, just
the
make sure it's
disappear.
Together.
Yeah, so then what do? Do you eat more, eat less? Or like, what do you do with the diet when you're not expending all the calories that you were before?
I did a lot of research into that, and I think
the conclusion
I came to is you're better off kind of keeping it the same. Unless it's going to be like weeks and weeks. You know, you're better off just kind of keeping it the same.
Yeah.
If you're going to have extra calories, you can use that towards recovering a little better during the time off.
For myself personally, from a mental standpoint, if I'm not just, I usually train Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and maybe a weekend day. I usually don't train Tuesday and Thursday. Tuesday and Thursday mentally is always harder for me to eat as much as I do on those other days, just because I have that in the back of my mind. I'm going to go lift tonight. I need it.
Yeah.
You know, and then on Tuesdays and Thursdays, it's like, I don't deserve it. Like, what do I need? Like, I'm just going to get fat today.
Sometimes the way I play it in my head is like, oh, I have a big lift tomorrow. I have to get prepped today so my body can feed off of this.
Or the way I always think of it, and this may not be scientifically true at all, but
I don't think any of this is scientific. It's just my game.
If I made the impression of anything that anything that I've ever said had any scientific proof or backing, I take that.
I always think of it like if I train the day before and I'm sore and I hurt, that's when I should be eating more.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if
that's probably
true or not.
I think that's better. There's got to be more logic backing that than what I was saying. You know what?
Maybe.
I was saying is kind of probably the opposite.
So what does it mean
true?
When the day before is also your day after? They're the same day.
What if tomorrow never comes?
That is very true.
That's why I just eat a lot all the time.
Yeah.
I keep it at that.
So speaking of back issues, Tyler, you took us for a little spin on your inversion table.
I didn't even charge
an admission fee for that thing.
So my boss has owned some storage units, and we've had in our back office this Iron Man inversion table. If you're listening, you don't know what that is. You hang by your feet.
Is it anything like the Captain America inversion table?
I don't think so. less PC. basically you hang upside down by your feet. You sit and you strap in, and it flips you upside down. Anyway, we had this thing sit in our back office, and I would use it from time to time. And then finally I just said, well, what's your plan for this thing? And he said, well, I don't really have a plan. I said, well, what do you want for it? Nothing. You can have it. And then he said, well, maybe if you promise to make sure your work van's clean once a week. And I said, well, how much can I just pay you for it? but anyway, so I got the thing for free, and I'm not going to clean my van every week, no matter what he says. But I don't know. It's cool. I like it. I don't know. What was your impression of it?
I can see how once you get comfortable with the sensation, like I know Tanner went first, and he was at about a 45-degree angle. It's like, am I doing it, guys?
Yeah. I was convinced that I was like beyond vertical at that point. Like I could fall out at any time. And they're like, dude, you're not even halfway there.
Not even close.
But I think once you get used to the sensation of being upside down and just kind of comfortable with the head rush part of it, I can see how once you relax, it could really kind of ease some pressure and turn into some type of rehab thing. Even Nick, we interviewed Nick, I think he said that was kind of part of his rehab.
Yeah, he did.
Some time on the inversion table.
And he didn't have a large variety of equipment in his gym. No. One thing he had was an inversion table.
Yeah.
We should have checked if it was an Iron Man one, though. That could be the deal breaker there.
This one is $150 on Amazon if you're into it.
But
yeah,
so it's not more.
Yeah, the cool thing about it, though, is like we were talking, you know, a lot of times these like almost gimmicky sounding things, like you think they're made for someone under 6 foot and under 200 pounds. What to go up to is someone
6 foot six is the top height and 295. So like
you're fitting most people.
So they made it for you?
It's basically made for me. Yeah, so that part's good. And it's stout. Like, it's pretty solid. It's not a piece of shit.
No, I was really shocked. I guess in my mind, if someone says inversion table, I always just thought that was a piece of shit.
Yeah.
Like that you just buy from Walmart or somewhere like that. And
yeah,
like,
you better hope that those ankle boots are keeping you in.
No,
I was nervous about that, but I guess if Tyler does it, so it's should be all right.
No, I sure wouldn't still be like doing anything fast on the fucking thing. You know?
Let her rip, baby. Yeah.
And it, for me, like, I'm like a little more used to being upside down with doing senseless CrossFit things. So the head rush isn't as big of a deal to me as it's probably a really new experience for you.
I don't like it. Made me feel bad. Not a good feeling. Not a head rush. Like, ooh, that was a rush.
just makes you want to throw up.
Yeah, I did kind of want to throw up.
And that was my sensation was after putting down two pieces of pizza, it just felt like these things are not sitting the way they're supposed to be right now.
For me, it fucking hurts my feet hanging all my body weight on
I wanted
ankles.
To like keep my ankles at like, or my feet at a 90-degree angle, hoping that those would save me if something gave out, but... It's like that's not really what it would even do.
And you get so tense just trying to
not fall.
Or like I'm uncomfortable. I got to keep my feet here, and then you don't realize that you're supposed to be relaxing your spine.
Yeah.
I don't know. Now that I have it, I'm gonna try and do it like every day for a while and see if it makes a difference. I've done every imaginable thing you can do, like with my back. Every night it's been like stretching and foam rolling and lacrosse balling and digging in my fucking back with God knows what other tools I have, and I have a TENS machine that I hook up. So I've done like, I literally do all of those things every day.
Do you think the inversion table, do you think it'll make you any taller though?
I would think that it would have to, wouldn't it?
I don't know how it couldn't.
There's no way it'll make you shorter.
Exactly.
Oh, gravity says otherwise.
Exactly.
Oh shit! But yeah, I don't know. My review of it I've used it probably a couple dozen times over the last year or so, just us having it at the office, and I would say it's moderately useful.
8 out of 10 would try again.
I would definitely try again. It's in my garage until it gets in the way, and then it might end up down at the basement gym in Massenomics. But
People would use it there. I mean,
I think so.
Some of those guys are into some, I don't know, some
at the very
weird,
least,
freaky
at
sex
at the very
stuff.
Least to take pictures of each other in.
It would be on Instagram. Yeah.
What else is new?
So I wanted to say, you know, I was on my way over here. It's a Friday night. Finished up my squat session at the gym and had to get a few pieces of pizza, you know, in my rush, and drove by the bar, and I just thought to myself, you know, I don't know what myself 4 years ago would think right now.
Of yourself today.
Yeah, you know, get done with your workout. Pathetic loser. Go sit in a guy's basement, do some podcasting, talking about lifting weights, and then I just thought, how far I've come. There's probably some deeper life meaning in there, but I don't know if I want to know that right now.
Just means we're not very cool people to hang out with.
This isn't pertinent to the podcast, but I'll ask it now anyways. Was it busy in the gym down there on a squat Friday night?
You know,
I figured maybe it was a little
it wasn't,
less busy.
It was definitely holiday. Less busy tonight.
Yeah.
Oh, I was going to say holiday, but Veterans Day.
Veterans Day, yeah.
I don't know. Do I say Happy Veterans Day, Tanner? Is that the correct?
I think that's a good nomenclature. I actually spoke today. I was the keynote speaker of a primary school today.
Okay.
For Veterans Day, and I had those little kids going.
About the horrors of war?
Yeah.
It was like Apocalypse Now.
It was like, war is hell, kids.
Yeah. So many weights.
And did they take anything away from it?
I taught them to yell something. There's about 10 different vets that came and spoke. And I'm not going to say everyone else's was boring isn't the right word, but it was just like...
They don't know how to play a crowd.
No, they didn't play the crowd at all. They didn't... I mean, the kids were 5 to 8 years old, so what they were
and
saying...
And that's your wheelhouse right there?
Yeah, I was like, I can relate to that. Like, you know, so I had
just started
going
with like a fart joke to really get them all?
No, I should have. But I got them going like yelling this chant thing, and I had them worked into a really good frenzy, and I was like... I'll just explain it really quickly here. In the Army... They teach you, like, if a drill sergeant or whatever, they ask you a question as a group, you reply with, huh? Like, you don't say, yes, that sounds great.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're not like, yeah. Everyone says, huh? So I taught them that, and then I got them going on it, and you know when you say, oh, that was pretty good, but I think you can do it louder. And we did that a few times, and then I really had them going, and I rapid-fired, like, 6 questions, and I was like... And do you love this flag? And they all were like, and do you love all these veterans? And they're like, and then I dropped the mic. And I was like,
and then some poor like Korean war vet was after you, and you're like,
that is exactly,
suck it, Elmer.
That is, there was a,
it wasn't my grandpa, was it?
There, I don't know, it was a Korean vet in a kind of a wheelchair walker. But he laughed. He could tell it was funny that he had to go next.
He had to follow that act up.
Yeah. So that's what I did for Veterans Day. We do have quite a few veterans at the gym. So
this
will come out later than that, but happy Veterans Day to those guys.
What we got? Do we have 5?
I think probably at least.
If not active duty currently.
Either. Yeah. I don't want to count out loud because I'll probably miss some and they'll feel left out. But yeah, we probably got at least that many.
Yeah.
So happy impressive. Veterans Day to those guys. Another cool thing is I work at a bank, so that meant
you didn't have to work.
No work today.
The bank's not open on Veterans Day?
No.
Really?
My wife's bank was open today.
Oh.
But she just didn't. She just took today off anyways.
I just can't keep straight how many days banks have off.
The Federal Reserve Bank is not open today, so their bank's
is
really...
Is that your guide?
That's everyone's.
That's the kind of star?
Generally, yeah. Not that anyone cares about this on the podcast. What did I interrupt something you were saying? Or
no, okay. He called you out on it.
Okay.
He just asked you about veteranness.
Because I had something else now, if we're done with that I could...
Well, we might not be ready for this thing, so... I think I was talking about something, though.
I do have a...
You were asking... We're going to go back here. You were asking about how the gym was.
So I did interrupt.
For a Friday, it was a very slow Friday. I like to think of Fridays as being the squat party, because they typically are. But we did have a new person there trying it out.
Yeah, here we go.
And it's really interesting when you kind of, after, you know, being down there a while, you kind of get used to everyone more or less knowing what's going on. It's just at this point, it's just kind of minor tweaks in technique mm-hmm. and just getting stronger.
Most people basically squat with a relatively solid technique.
Yeah, their form's more or less down at this point. Yeah,
unless I'm down there.
Or me. I was just going to say, except for like me, but.
So tonight we had someone down there that is brand new to it. And you don't realize that.
Brand new, like, as what do you in, think he's, do you think he's ever went in a weight room?
I had mentioned or? In high school, which was over, I mean, close to 20 years ago. So, you know, it's been, you could basically say brand new. And you realize that a squat is not a natural position, really, for people to get into. Like, it's not.
It's a, that, it is. At like one point in time. Well,
yes,
natural,
it, yes, it is.
But most people cannot get into it.
After you haven't done it for 30 years, it's no longer natural. Yeah. Well, you know, that's
and maybe a squat's natural. I think maybe just dropping into a squat might be natural, assuming you have the mobility. But now throwing a bar on your back, and that takes out of the whole the whole naturalness. So like watching someone, I forget, like, you know, we all do have a certain level of skill. We're not all complete morons.
Mm-hmm.
So kind of coaching that through was pretty interesting. And I guess my tip to kind of reinforce the squat was most people think it's knees. The squat is all knees when the way I like to think of it is kind of, you know, breaking out the hips.
Hip hinge first.
Yeah, it's a lot more hips and sticking your butt out and going from there. And we ended up getting the box involved. And I think once you give someone that box to know that they can sit on it and sit back into it, they can get the, you know, put more weight on their heels. And it clicked just like that. And I mean, the guy made pretty good progress. Like by the time he left.
Technically. Yeah. Technically.
Yeah.
Progress.
Yeah. By the time he left with just a barbell and going through the motion, it was a perfectly fine squat.
Mm-hmm.
So it is kind of, it's just interesting. You know, we get so into this and everyone moving hundreds of pounds that you forget how far probably we all have come in this lifting journey.
Just what people don't know that aren't exposed to that.
Yeah. Yeah. And even trying to explain something like an RDL or like a stiff legged deadlift, you know, that you still kind of are bending at the hips. Your back's not really doing much. Your back's kind of staying flat more or less the whole way through. It's just your hips. And that's not natural to teach to people either. You know, you don't, in your regular life, you don't really have to do anything with your hips. So like teaching your body to make that connection of how to move those things through, you can like really see people like focusing, like it'd probably be like if someone took us in a room and told us to like try to teach us how to dance, it'd be like, no, it's not happening. Like those pathways don't exist.
I'm probably the worst dancer that I know of, like anyone that I know, I'm the worst. So
I did take an 8-week ballroom dancing class. Whoa, once.
Could you do it? Could you go do it?
I could get it down. It took me some time. I had funny story was my wife, when we first moved back here, she just didn't feel like working because we were like staying at my brother's house while
club.
He was overseas.
The high life.
Yeah. So, but we were looking for a house, and she, I said, well, you're going to need to, you know, you're going to have to get a job before we can buy a house. We end up finding this house that we wanted to buy, and I said, well, but I can't put in an offer if you don't have a fucking job. And she said, fine. And this was on like a Friday. She's like, if I get a job by the weekend and we're able to then get the bank to send the stuff off so we can get the house, and if we get the house approved and we end up moving into the house, you have to take ballroom dancing classes with me. This is before we were married. So
you're still trying to like...
She wanted me to learn to dance so we could dance like real people at the wedding. And sure as shit, she goes and gets a job. Like after 4 months of not working, I realized that she just wasn't even trying to find a job until she had to. So then I got conned into then at that point I was tricked and I had to take ballroom dancing.
So did you do it at the wedding?
Yeah. Yeah.
And you looked like a frickin' star.
Like a boss, yeah. Yeah. I don't know if I still would have it
in
me
today. Did
you
do the rumba?
I only learned how to, what is it, the waltz?
It sounds right.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I think that's the only thing I learned how to do with the, like really fundamentally.
It sounds really classy, though.
With a few accessories, like
a couple little twirls.
Now you gotta spin. Yeah. But but that's the extent of my dancing.
Okay.
That and just the white guy, hands in the air stuff.
Yeah.
Oh, I can rock that white boy, like a lot of beers deep, letting the music go and just jumping like a crazy man. Yeah.
Just feeling it.
I'll do
like
that all day.
You let the music flow
you know,
through
you. You let those mustard beats get on, and it's game over for everyone.
I usually do avoid it at all costs until I'm just that drunk. And then it's fun.
It's just right.
Yeah, and that, like, you just hit a certain threshold and it's like, oh, wait, that does look... maybe that is fun.
I'm really doing it, guys.
Yeah, yeah. You just hope there's not a video camera out at that point in time.
I got... So, see, I'm the same way. I won't, like, actively, like, go to, like, a nightclub and be like, oh, I'm going to fucking dance tonight. But
you're a bottle service guy, right?
Yeah. The last VIP. Did I tell a story about when we got drugged when we were in Mexico?
I've not heard this.
No.
So the last time we went to Mexico, we went to...
Wait, which time that you got drugged in Mexico?
This was the last time I got drugged. Okay. Accidentally. but we were there and we were staying at this resort and we go into the place and it was all inclusive. So you don't have to buy any of your drinks. And we got there like right as the place was kind of starting to tip off. So we got our spots right by the dance floor and we were already pretty housed and we went up and each of us tipped the bartenders like $20 and there was quite a few of us. And then our server came over and we each tipped him like, they each probably got like $150 out of us right when we walked in just as a tip so we didn't have to worry about it and didn't realize with the conversion rate apparently that that's an impactful amount of money.
Month's salary.
To them down there. And I think they misinterpreted it as like, oh, we should give these guys drugs.
Oh.
Because I have partied a lot in my life and I have had a lot of awesome times, but about probably 45 minutes after we got there, we are all out on the dance floor dancing like fucking lunatics. And everybody else in all the pictures that we took, everybody else out there looks like normal people. And we're all just dripping with sweat. We're just sweating to beat all hell. And I think at some point I had leaned over to someone else that was there with us. And I was like, this is the most incredible night of my fucking life.
So do you think it was like some Jack 3D that they put in
the good stuff?
Yeah. The pre-ban.
Is this where your tequila pre-workout concoction grew from?
No. But whatever it was that they gave us was probably pretty awesome. I'd pay for it again, I guess. But that night, for real, we danced for like 6 hours. Like 6 hours. Like
that's a workout, huh?
Yeah, it was pretty intense. Did not feel that good the next day either. But we were able to drink through that since it was an all-inclusive place.
Yeah. You gave me the recommendation, Barbell Shrug, they recently had on the Squat University guy.
Dr. Aaron Horschig.
A.K.A.
the fucking man.
Yeah. Did you listen to that at all?
No, I just saw the clips of it. I think
they did a few
some
videos.
Stuff on Instagram or something, and I saw it pop up there, which I'm like, hey, cool, I know both of these people.
Yeah, so I watched it, listened to it, actually, and he said the word right. I don't know. I wanted to count, but
I saw that in the comments, actually. That
they made a meme of it, even. Yeah. They just had a picture of him, and it just said right, ?
Yeah,
how many times do you think he said the word right?
300?
Yeah, I was going to say 500 times. I don't know. At the end of every sentence, right?
Yeah.
Right?
That's how he finished every sentence, right?
What he said was he was like, that's what happens when I have a whole bunch of coffee.
Really?
Yeah.
Someone confronted him about it, actually?
Yeah. Oh,
okay. They were making a joke. They couldn't not bring it up because there was a right, like every 5 seconds there was a right in there. But they made a joke of it.
I actually didn't catch it until like halfway through because it just went right over my head. And then once it started...
Once
I noticed it, I was like, oh my God, he's been saying this the whole time. But they did a few other things other than just the podcast. They got some videos on YouTube that they had done with how to break down people's squat, foot mechanics, you know, ankle mobility, and some of those other things that was fucking really good. Like as good information as what he puts out that I would highly, highly recommend checking out. Made me again look at it like, God damn it, my ankle mobility's shit, you know. But
yeah, he's awesome. He knows his stuff. He's really interesting to listen to. And I don't bring that up to make fun of him. What I was actually thinking is it reminded me how I say you know a lot. I use you know like he says,
to fill,
right.
To fill in the gap.
Yeah, like I end a sentence with you know?
I don't remember what it is that I say, but I say it. I probably have like four things that I lean on all the fucking time.
I don't say but I just make the noise like, ah. Sometimes I'll listen to the podcast that we did and I'll be like, did I just say ah for like 10 seconds there? You know, why was I saying ah?
He locked up.
Somebody hit him. What else did we have for today, guys?
Tanner has something that
I do have a really big surprise.
Waiting to drop on.
If you're,
I've been warned about this 2 weeks ago, and I've just been patiently.
If you're
waiting.
Watching on video, you're gonna see this here too. Actually, oh, okay, we're.
Well, maybe we should talk about something else first.
No, because what I'm about to show you guys is gonna take us a little time to do something with it. So I need to make sure we're not too close to the end of the podcast. Okay.
Oh no, we got time.
Yeah. So in this bag.
Oh God.
I've got a very special surprise.
Is it a snake? Because I hate snakes.
It is a trouser snake. No, this is. I bought this recently. And
is that the bow tie?
Yeah, this is the bow tie made by Donnie Thompson. And I talked to Donnie Thompson. He's,
oh, we're name dropping.
Yeah, me and Donnie are pretty good buddies. And
hashtag BFFs.
I told him. That I was thinking about maybe doing a review on this for the website and wanted to put it out there and stuff. And his suggestion was that on the podcast, I should have one of you guys try it on while we're doing it. Cause you wear it for about 10 minutes at a time or so, he said. And then, just when you take it off, just say what you feel. So Tyler, you should probably put it on cause it's about your size. You can try it afterwards, but it's going to be a little bit bigger.
Yeah.
So you won't get like the full effect.
Yep.
But I was thinking Tyler could throw it on, and then when he takes it off, just say like what you
just say one word.
Just describe. But I'm gonna come over there and help you put it on.
Okay. Because I have no idea what I'm doing.
Okay, I'll fill in the gaps for anyone that can't see this. All right, Tyler. Again, I don't know why your pants have to come
off. Is
this
some weird sex thing, Tanner?
It depends on your definition of weird. So
okay.
Pull these like into you a little bit.
So it kind of looks like the top half of like a parachute almost.
Then like that. Does that feel fairly snug?
Yeah.
Okay.
You look pretty upright right now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Say you're what you feel just putting on to begin with.
So,
on like, I mean, it goes on pretty easy. But like once it's on, I feel like my. I mean, it's weird because it's just across my shoulders, but my posture.
Yeah, you're sitting up like all of like Tyler.
You can't
relax, man.
You know, yeah, like you. It seems like you can't slough off, and it's not uncomfortable or anything like that. But
so
like
this is okay. What is this thing called? The bow tie.
The bow tie, and there's two versions of the bow tie. This one is the formal.
Okay.
And there's also a casual. The formal is made out of a stiffer material, so this is probably the stiffer of the two. And I knew
Tyler
how you liked them
the
extra
stiff.
I knew it was a weird sex thing.
But Spud Inc. manufactures it.
Is that his company?
No. No, it's not. But, what you know, he kind of is an inventor.
Okay.
And he also makes the Thompson Fat Pad,
yep.
Which is a very wide, large pad people use for bench pressing.
Yep.
And then he also makes the Fat Bells, which are the kettlebells that you stick your hand into.
Like a fucking superhero fist.
Yeah, it's like
it like wraps. It's just a cannonball that you put your hand inside.
Oh, I haven't seen those.
So it's funny. Like, you see people do curls with it.
Yeah,
it's like you see their arm just right here.
It just looks like a badass fist.
Yeah, it's like a Hulk hand, like one of those toy.
I was
kind of
wondering if they wouldn't make some that are like
colored.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
I don't know if we had talked about it before, like the Captain America bumper plates that they had that looked really badass, but. To do like a Hulk hand version of the Fat Bell would be pretty sweet.
So he invented all
we'll
that stuff.
We'll take a royalty check for that idea when it comes out.
That's right. With that,
you heard it here first, Donnie.
So you can buy these now. Rogue and Elite FTS are both marketing these for him. Now you can buy it at either site.
So it's something like that.
Is there a version of this that you would wear like around?
The casual one you could wear around. Either of these you kind of
could, you probably couldn't wear it like with a t-shirt.
Yeah.
With the straps.
Like, in that, actually, it chafes you after a while. Like, it's in your armpits in a weird mm-hmm. place. You know, it's not comfy. So it's not supposed to be.
The, but what's the, like, usage guidelines? Like, 10 minutes at a time, half hour?
That's interesting. Like, there, you maybe... When I bought it, they weren't being marketed yet by Rogue or Elite FTS. You had to go sign it kind of like Spud Inc.'s own website, which isn't like an awesome website with good information. Actually, to find out what size I needed, I had to message Donnie and be like, I'm this size. Like, which one do you think I should get?
Yeah.
Because there wasn't even a sizing chart yet or anything. And he told me to get that's a 2XL. So that's probably the size he would tell for you to wear too. But I asked him, like, how long am I supposed to wear this, or what do you do with it? You know, what?
Can I just, I want to buy it just because.
But... I was like, should I wear it for like an hour at a time is what I asked. And he said, well, maybe do it like an hour throughout the day. So maybe about 4 15-minute sessions.
Uh-huh.
And he said, usually people don't use it to train. You don't train while you're wearing it, but sometimes people do that. He said you can do that.
Yeah.
That's not typically the use, but I have seen people doing that on Instagram.
Seems like it'd be in the way a little bit of that,
too. Yeah, I think so. But his recommendation was wear it for about 10 to 15 minutes on doing anything, sitting, standing. What he said is it's not a brace. It is therapeutic through a couple ways. One is just through the basic compression.
Mm-hmm.
It's just tight on your shoulders.
Yeah.
So when you take that off, because of that compression that's there for 10 or 15 minutes, it's going to increase blood flow to that area.
Oh, yeah.
And you'll be able to feel that, I think. And then besides that, it's for humeral alignment. So
does that mean it's funny to look at?
Puts your humor right in line.
Puts it right in line with like Massenomics style humor. But you just, it's putting your arms, your shoulders
where into they need to be.
Where they should be.
Yeah.
They're not there because we all do this and this. Mm-hmm. And
just dying chained to a computer.
Yeah, exactly. So it reinforces you being in that position is the basic thing. You know, the position you should be in.
So this is the formal bow tie.
That's the formal one. And there's the casual, which is I haven't touched it, but it is black. And
is that a racial thing? I don't know why you had to bring the color into this, Tanner.
I usually try to do that like once an episode, but I'm glad someone did. But no, I don't think so. If you're asking seriously. So that's kind of what I know about it. And his recommendation is just try it in a few different ways. Maybe try it doing a few different things and just see what you like. But he did emphasize to me that it's not a brace.
So it's not something you're going to wear all day.
No, exactly.
So what's the... Let me see the back here.
And you can put it on yourself. That's why I went over and helped him put it on. It's got those straps in the front because you want to... You kind of did it naturally. You know, you kind of grab onto those and you can pull it up. And,
mm-hmm.
But what's nice to do, he kind of recommended it, if you do have someone, is pull down the back. And I saw what someone even said is...
Gets it down below your... In your lats.
Yeah, you can even... That's what he said. If pull those down under your lats almost if you can on the back, and it really puts it in a...
Pulls you... Yeah.
Nice position.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Does it make my boobs look huge?
No, it just really looks like you're sitting... Right, it just really...
Has some exceptional posture.
Yeah, it does. That is what it's like.
The interesting thing that I feel, at least with having it on, is that you don't... I think some of your shitty posture, sometimes you think it will start with the lower back, but mm-hmm. once this is forced to be in like the correct place...
Yeah, it'd be really hard to have a really upper...
Because you have to...
Yeah, to like keep your upper back.
You can't fall apart.
And then let your lower back...
Yeah. It would be interesting to wear this like... To drive, I drive all the time at work.
So
to just drive for like 15 minutes with it somewhere, and then take it off, just so I have a reminder of like,
that's exactly here's how you're it supposed is. To it sit. Is a reminder. That's what you said is exactly a thing that he said too. It is a reminder of how you should be.
Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty cool. I get to keep this, right?
No.
Oh, fuck.
So how much does something like this run?
I don't know. You could pull it up probably if you wanted to, but
might be complicated.
Oh, okay.
Let's see what we can do. Do you remember what the website is again?
Well, you can go to Rogue.
Okay, yeah.
And just type in Bowtie.
It's Rogue Fitness, right?
You're the one that does CrossFit.
Rogueexercising.com.
Here's the deal. In our dungeon, in the Massenomics studio dungeon, my Wi-Fi signal doesn't reach very far.
Oh,
so the last couple days we've been doing it, I've had the mobile hotspot on my phone, which I don't have on right now.
I was going to say, because you did it like really schnazzy the...
Yeah, I was a little more prepared.
You're bipping and bopping all over the place, like pulling up screens.
Connecting the interwebs across the room.
I know.
But I think it was about $50.
Okay.
You know?
Yeah.
Some 55 maybe. I can't remember exactly.
Yeah.
And I would also say this item certainly is not a necessity for anyone, but...
hey, it's a cool thing to try out.
It is a cool thing to try out.
I mean, you're going to spend money on stupid shit at some point anyways. Yeah, I mean, and I'm not saying it's stupid shit, but like there's a lot of worse things you could spend I spent $50 at the bar after our party and I don't remember hardly being at the bar.
Right. And I kind of have a shoulder thing going on anyway, so I was just like, "Yeah, this is a shoulder."
So how much have you used it so far?
I try to use it at least once every single day.
Yeah.
And I usually wear it. Sometimes I actually wear it 2 or 3 times a day, and usually at least 10 minutes a time, sometimes 20 minutes a time.
Uh-huh.
And there it is. There's the
$60.
Yeah. There's the formal.
Okay.
Does it have a sizing chart? There's a 4X.
The only thing that they have left is 4X.
Oh.
Ooh. Flying off the shelves.
Yeah. Jesus. Tanner got in early.
I was, and that's why... You know, I was going to bring this to the podcast, like...
They do have a fit guide.
Okay. It's just your body
weight. It's just body... Yeah. Whatever.
Which is kind of...
Yeah, based on this, I would be a 3XL, but I would not recommend...
You don't... I think you want it to be pretty tight.
I would think so.
You know?
I mean, too tight might be an issue, but not as much as too loose.
Yeah, if it's too loose, it's just not going to do what you... Too tight is going to make it more uncomfortable, but... So it's just a different material. You can see that that probably looks quite a bit stretchier.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it looks pretty comparable to what you see with like wraps.
It kind of looks.
That's what I thought you were pulling.
It actually kind of looks like the slingshot, the hip circle material. The casual one does.
I thought it was Nick's. I thought it was a pair of SBD wrist wraps, right?
Yeah,
because they're that same red material.
Well, what I think the one Tyler's wearing, the formal one, I think that material reminds me of the slingshot. Knee wraps. It's like a little bit stiffer,
almost canvas.
Yeah, canvas like material.
That's pretty legit, but you can't buy it on Rogue basically unless you're fucking huge.
Really? What was the weight for
4XL? Let's see what their sizing chart is.
How much do you have to weigh to get a
4X? For
300 plus.
300 plus. Well, fuck. I could eat a big meal and be 4X. Go from a 2X to a 4X. But no, that's the only size they had. It does say they'll notify you once it's back in stock if you sign up. But
I've seen it on Instagram a lot now in the last week or two. I think it's gotten pretty popular. And for anyone that doesn't know Donnie Thompson, if you're into lifting and then interested in anything recovery-wise, mobility and different improving your mobility and recovery, he knows his stuff for sure. And he's got a lot of different... things that you probably haven't seen before that would be interesting and, you know, might be worth a try if you're having issues on something.
What's his? Does he have a website?
That's his. I don't know. He's Super D is his nickname. I think. What's his Instagram? Oh, he's a former powerlifter. He's a real big guy. He used to be a lot bigger, and he doesn't compete anymore, and he's gotten a lot smaller. But
he's got that. He does the body tempering stuff, so he has like the ex-wife where it's like a 150-pound steel, like piece of round steel.
I want to get one of those after watching him use that
Is
stuff.
Is that kind of like that boomstick?
Yeah, that's a larger even than the boomstick,
These things, it looks pretty odd. There's a lot of times where I've had something where it's like, oh, I just need a massive fucking steel just make it hurt.
Do you just put it on you basically just and to roll, get the like, muscle to just give
finally? Yeah. Usually someone has to help you with body tempering or whatever he calls it. But usually you're laying there relaxed and someone is doing it for you and it's extremely painful because it's a 200-pound
implement
thing on the rolling muscles over your bicep or whatever.
It hurts you know. Yeah. Okay, I think it's been on for more than 10 minutes.
Yeah.
So I just take it off.
Yeah. We'll see how graceful you are at that.
You're just going to leave this up to me. You weren't going to tell me how this was going to go. That wasn't so bad.
Well, you're not out yet.
Oh, fuck. I got a thumb stuck.
You talked a little too early there.
All right.
So what do you feel?
I feel really loose in my shoulders. Like, really loose. I think
it was going to be too big for me.
That's what she... Never mind.
Yeah, it's just
it
too
looks
big.
Too big. Yeah, it's not. Big. Is it even tight?
If I really wedge it in there and slide it down,
Have Tyler pull it down.
Yeah, pull it down, then it can get some tightness in. Yeah,
and
there we go.
That'll help a little bit. And even pull each one of his straps individually and try and pull those down if you can.
I'll pull down while he pulls the straps.
Or what pull do these mean? Down? Or
well, no,
like on the sides.
Yeah, on the sides of the bottom. Pull those there, down there, like there, that. There. Yeah, that'll help a little bit.
Yeah,
that helps. Okay.
Yeah, my shoulders feel like, and also like, I can move in so many places. Whereas I felt for a long, like, my shoulders just are where they are, I think. But
like right now I'm having kind of anxiety that I want to put it on after like you talking about the way, because I know how it is. And I'm like, oh, I kind of want mine to feel like that again.
Yeah.
I can already see, you know, this is not properly fit for me at all. But I can already see like, it's almost like someone's just performing like, kind of a stretch on my upper back almost. Like it's just kind of put me into place.
I dig it.
Can you feel what I was talking about via what he said is like the compression almost where it's actually sitting?
A little bit, but I think a lot of that was like my arms started tingling too from cutting off a bit of circulation.
Yeah.
So I'm getting this kind of like rush of blood to my whole...
Yeah.
All my extremities.
To everything.
Maybe not everything.
This rush of blood. There's only so much blood to go around at once. So what do you think? Did you like it?
I like it. Yeah. I'll probably have to get one. Yeah. I'll definitely have to get one.
And it's like, I mean, do you feel like you have a shoulder problem or?
Not really.
But this made them
my
feel
shoulders
better.
Feel better. And I don't have like shoulder pain on the regular, you know, I have some rotation issues with squatting, but like, yeah, I don't feel like walking around like
I've been wearing something wrong. I do too. I've been wearing it prior to my back squat days. I like wear it on the way to the gym, basically a little bit before and on the way, just because I think it helps a little
helps you open up a little bit.
Yeah, I think so.
Because I think this kind of feeds into the thing. At least this is kind of how I feel about the squat is. I think one of the reasons that I feel like I can stay so tight and upright is because I can bring my shoulders in so far.
Mm-hmm.
And I think if, you know, this thing does help you get back and give you that mobility. So I could see how that could even be, I mean, carry over to helpfulness with the squat even.
Right. What would you guys think about wearing that while you perform a squat? I never have.
Like, honestly, for me, I feel like it puts me naturally in the position I want to be in.
Yeah.
Like, cause I naturally want to be arms way back in here.
If I were to, I would do it just as I'm working with like a barbell.
And then
maybe like throw a plate on.
Yeah. Just helping you get
just mainly to be set, like to have a cue to be fully set.
Yeah, it's a cue.
As you get back underneath the bar. And then I think I would take it off just for me because
it's in the way.
It would be in the way, but no, I dig it. I dig it a lot.
Do you want to pull me down again?
Yeah.
Since I can't quite fill this bad boy out.
When you're done with him, can you give me a couple tugs over here?
A real good tug over here.
You can wear it when you drive home.
No, I didn't mean on the...
Oh. No. But I'm glad you asked. Yeah.
I would say, though, like, the weirdest thing about this is why you feel like you sit so much more upright when you're... Like, I feel like my lower back is really upright, but I think it's just the fact that my shoulder blades are like retracted and not hunched forward. Which...
So you work at a desk all day. What do you think this would be like if you threw this on once every 2 hours or something? Do you think would?
So this is actually this is almost very timely that you brought this up because at work, amongst our department this week, we've talked a decent amount about ergonomics, standing desks, getting monitors at the correct height, because you don't realize that you put that thing down at the wrong level and all of a sudden you're just hunched over.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you don't even think about it. It's just, you just kind of revert to that
top of the monitor, even with your eyesight.
pretty much, yeah. And so I got that thing raised up, raised the roof on that baby this weekend. But
I have a hard time just doing Massenomics things with, like, because I just do all our shit off a laptop. It's like, but if I'm doing shit for an hour or two, having it just on a fucking table is the worst.
Yeah, well, that's why it's so hard for me personally to do Massenomics stuff. It's like to sit at a desk for 8 hours and then to go home and be like, all right, let me crank out this for another 2.5 hours. All right, I got 10 hours in at a desk today.
I've the standing desk thing that you bring that up. I work at a desk all day too, and I have insane hip tightness with squatting and stuff. And I've been thinking for a long time about just buying my own standing desk at work and just, or like they make it for your regular desk that you can put on there.
There's a crazy amount of options that you can put on top of a desk. Yeah. Actually, one of the more interesting ones we saw this week, because we did talk about this a decent amount, is there's a company that makes a cardboard one, and it's like $25, and it's you know, obviously it's not adjustable, it's just, but it's made of industrial cardboard, and do you got it there on stand? That might be it.
Let's see. I'm gonna read this article here.
It says screw those $300 stands.
the downside to this one, that's what it is right there.
No shit. So it's just like collapsible.
And your keyboard goes on the one level, and then your monitor and everything goes on the next level, which...
Get on my level.
Seems, I mean, $25, like, that's a pretty solid deal, but...
That's their marketing plan. It's like, I'll give it a shot. What's
the worst that could happen?
That
means their cost is like $1.25. So, interesting. It's called the Oristand, ORI stand.co.
And once you enter the world of stand-up desks, there is...
Limitless.
Whether you want to go like up, like stuff that already goes up top, where like the Vera desk that's like adjustable, you could go from sitting to standing in like 10 seconds to... I mean, there's tons of like wood.
That sounds like a really easy way to like fuck up all your cords.
See, my biggest fear is that at work, being a graphic designer, all of our stuff is on Macs. And currently, like, the setups we use is an iMac where the whole computer is built into one. Mm-hmm. So it's not like you make a mistake and you drop your monitor and you're out $150 screwed. Bucks. Like, you drop it, you broke a $2,000 computer. Like, it's a pretty big deal. So something, I still haven't found that perfect solution. But, I mean, there are some, but they would be fairly expensive. So I don't know what the perfect option is.
I guess just get a bunch of Windows computers, and then you could wreck 10 of them.
Yeah. disposable at that point.
I can't get there. Okay, so Oristand's website is dog shit.
It's nothing like that. Have you ever been to that Massenomics.com?
The Massenomics.com website, I bet, is going to load up silky fast smooth. As shit. Look at this. Boom.
Yeah, it's there.
Look at that, guys. Wow. How fast did that load? You're getting to
lay on the camera because it's so fast.
Yeah, look at how fast that loaded. Woo.
Holy
We did it. We did win that. We do have a couple new things as far as articles that have been out. This one even
I just put slid that on
under
there.
My radar.
I just put it on there.
Slide it in.
I had made it, and I was like, oh, let the people
So we
want.
Do have a...
it hasn't been beta tested, so I don't know if the link's going to work or not yet. But.
We do have a spreadsheet for... all sorts of magical
That's
things.
Just
you want
a picture.
You want to explain that, Tanner?
Yeah, it's a spreadsheet that you can.
Tanner loves spreadsheets.
I've been known to like spreadsheets before. It's
a real number cruncher.
Yeah, a common passion that Shane and I share. Big Shane from the gym. We talk spreadsheets sometimes when we're not talking heavy bench presses or something like that. But it's just there's other of these on the internet, but I just wanted our own, and I hadn't seen one that gives you times body weight and Wilk score all in one.
Oh, there we go.
And then I also threw a Watts formula in on that too.
Oh, that's what it is. It's times body weight.
Yeah.
When I first looked at it, I thought it was a calculation to like figure out what your ex girlfriend's body weight was. It's ex's body weight. I was like, huh.
If she's gotten real fat since you know her.
Like, so if
two
you,
times her old body
if you,
weight.
If you lift a, yeah, if your numbers are really big, they'll be heavier. I see.
So yeah, that and at the very if you, that red, the red lettering, a little higher right there, a little higher right there. I think that is
the
that's what I haven't
sheet.
Actually checked yet. Oh, there
it all.
Is it actually
it all works
that's going to ruin my computer.
Yes.
Okay. Perfect.
It's malware phishing other things
Trojan.
Other things that our IT department sends me at work not to click on.
Tanner's really good at spreadsheets, but not so much at virus scans.
No. So that's it, and you can do it in either you just select pounds or kilograms, and then you can fill in your info and see what everything comes out to.
And does this give them all access to the secret Massenomics cloud files also or not?
I think just this one. Okay. I'm not even sure.
Wait a minute.
I assumed it wasn't going to get clicked on a ton, to tell you the truth. I thought just maybe it would look cool if someone stumbled on it.
Honestly, nobody's listening to this either. So.
So that's that.
Yeah. Tommy, you want to take your shoulder straps off, see how you feel?
I would love to. Yep, I got the thumb stuck too.
I'm telling you, it's a trap.
You know, it wasn't as tight on me, so I don't think it's as immediate, but it does feel like, why do I have so much mobility in these things? Like,
after it's gone.
I'm ready to do like some dancing over here.
And they didn't pay us for this, and they certainly didn't give Tanner this for free. So this is at least fairly objective.
Oh, yeah.
I mean.
Yeah, that's what he wanted.
They didn't pay us yet.
When I talked to him, that's what he wanted. Yeah. He's like, just put it on and just say what you think.
Yeah.
Because he's confident enough about it that he knows when you take it off after wearing it, you'll be like, oh.
Oh, shit.
That does kind of... At the very least, you'd be like, that does kind of feel
and
nice.
And even now, it's probably 10 minutes after I took it out, I can move my shoulder blades, which I kind of is a problem for me, you know. I dig it. I give it a definite would use again.
Would try again.
Yeah,
I would too. That was kind of cool.
Mm-hmm. And yeah. I mean, a better fitting one.
Yeah, a better fitting one would obviously probably really impress me. Mm-hmm. So if someone wants to like send me one, I'll demo that for you.
Spud Inc., Rogue, Elite FTS, Dunny Thompson.
So did we have anything else to run down today, guys?
Anything else?
Ooh, no. We do have probably some articles coming out maybe by the time that this...
We actually have a huge backlog of articles that we're just finishing up for you and figuring out what to drop.
Just waiting next. To drop on you like a bunch of bombs.
It's actually a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah, we do have... We have like four pretty damn good articles I'd that are say, coming your way. So prepare to get your face blown off.
And in the meantime, you can still go to Massenomics.com and
read
check out
old shitty ones.
Check out all our old super shitty articles. So I've been listening to some other podcasts, you guys, and we're gonna not do this now, but from here on out, we're gonna start splitting up the wrap up fucking responsibilities. So someone's gonna have to pimp the website.
Can we vote on this?
And then someone else is gonna pimp the Facebook thing, and someone else will hustle the Instagram and such.
I don't think we should just make major changes. Like
that. Yeah, we should probably talk about this off air.
Problem.
This is gonna sound kind of weird
this
now.
This is why I brought it up on here, is because I fucking mess it up all the time. We're gonna hand off something, but
that's like at home if my wife tells me that
you need to start doing the
and
dishes.
It's like no, you do it so good. You're so good. You do a way better job than me. Like I suck. I'm a shitty human being. I'm a dumb man. Like I could never wash them as good as you.
And she's just talking about you. You wiping your own butt, right?
That's a whole nother story. But really, like, really praise them and really put yourself down.
What I do actually is I just do such, don't get any ideas either, guys, but I do such a shitty job when I'm asked to do something new that I don't want to do that, like,
they're like, oh,
they'll never, she'll never ask again.
Yeah. There's a lot of little tricks you learn after.
Yeah. Or like, if it's like, you're going to fold and put away those clothes until the clothes pile and pile. And I'm content with living out of the pile.
Oh, yeah. That's how...
They're clean.
That's how God
they're
intended
fucking
men
clean.
To
and they're just in a pile. There's two or three baskets, but they're all in a corner. But they're all clean.
How about this? I don't know if there's enough time for this or not, but what about the... I have a theory that clothes aren't... It's not black and white where they're either clean or dirty.
There's a gray
area. There's a way gray area. Oh, yeah. If you're a man, your clothes... Like, well, 90% of my clothes live in that gray area where it's not dirty. It's not physically sweaty or dirty.
Even denim. Like, a lot of people say, like, denim should not be washed regularly.
I'll wear jeans.
I'm doing good, then.
I'm not three to four times for
sure. Yeah, I mean, I'm not throwing on jeans and just sweating and I'm like I'm at the gym or anything.
No. Now, I will if I... And I now don't get me wrong, guys. I have what would be categorized as just somewhat subpar hygiene. Like, it's not terrible, but it's certainly not exceptional. Yeah. But like, if I work out in the clothes, they're certainly dirty. Every article of clothing, but that's just because I'm kind of disgusting.
What about if you're wearing tights and your shorts like are pretty sort?
For me, I would still be done with them.
Shorts are all
bad. For me, anything I work out, well, with the exception of my sweats I wear over the top to warm up, I'll let those things get kind of grimy because it's at the gym. But everything else, like I work out in it, like it gets
grimy. And then it's dirty. But that's white, black and white. Then it's dirty, but not working out clothes.
But nothing else falls under that. Yeah,
right.
Basically, yeah. If I wear, t-shirts, I'll usually wash after one time. But, like, if it's something that I might have to fucking iron, like, if I'm wearing a shirt that I have to button up, I'm definitely not doing anything too nasty in it. So, it's going back on the hanger when I'm done, for sure.
Good. I think most men agree with
that. And hooded sweatshirts are good for at least 10 wears.
Are you even supposed to wash those?
Seasons with
if they have a zipper, it's annually.
Yeah, it's a coat.
It's annually.
Yeah.
I have, like, a Carhartt jacket for work. And that I haven't washed in 4 years.
Man, it's a coat. That's the whole point of them.
I wouldn't know how to wash it if
But at the same time, that thing probably gets a lot of like fresh air, like air blown on it.
Oh yeah.
And that's almost like hanging it out.
Yeah. Plus, it spends the whole summer stuffed behind my driver's seat.
that's good. That article is in like a perpetual gray area for
forever
of existence. Yes. Yeah. It's not clean. But it's not dirty like it needs to go through the washing machine.
No, and it probably never will be.
No.
No. Yeah.
I don't know if I've ever washed a coat in my life, to be honest.
Are we really disgusting?
No. I mean, someone out there is going to say that or think that, but they're just lying.
They're just wrong.
Yeah, they're just making a point. They do it too.
Yeah.
So
plus it gets so cold around here, I think that the cold takes off all the stink.
For sure. That's a fact. Well, send us all of your poor hygiene pictures.
Poor hygiene tips.
Oh, one other thing. Right. Not about poor hygiene.
God damn it, Tanner. Here's what happens every episode. I am just about to finish. I say, do you guys have anything else?
And
Tanner's like, you know what? No, I think we're all good. And I'm like, okay, that's going to wrap it up. Tanner's like, oh, wait. Yeah. We're on our third Tanner interjection.
No, speaking of really poor hygiene, the This Is Female Powerlifting Girls had their first podcast episode out.
Yes.
Speaking of really poor hygiene. No, not really.
That's not very nice.
No, not. They would appreciate that joke, I think. But no, and I listened to that, and that was pretty cool. But I was just going to say, anyone that listened to the podcast that you did with them and thought that was kind of cool, they should probably check that out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and they have that now. Theirs is on iTunes as well. And they jumped right to video, too. As well, so they'll have it on their YouTube channel also.
And
so.
Everyone listening, I went on iTunes and gave them a freaking review, and it wasn't that hard.
It was pretty easy to do.
It was pretty easy, so...
Like a civilized person.
Yeah, I know there's more than 13 people that listen to our podcast, but we have 13 reviews. So...
And if you've listened to us try to end this podcast 3 or 4 times and we're still going now and you're still listening.
And you haven't given us a review.
Jesus Christ. Get it together.
Like,
you are the worst person.
Yeah. Quit being a prick.
Let's say the next option would be just send us money then. If you're not going to leave us a review, just send us $150.
Yeah. Really, we're just asking like for 20 seconds of your time.
Yeah.
Like, you don't even really have to write anything. You can hit the 5-star button and just say, good. Like that. That's good. Enough.
Or just hit 5 stars and say.
And you can say that
these
we
guys
suck.
Say these guys forced me to do this, and I hate them. But just give us 5 stars still.
Yeah, I mean, maybe don't do that. But we'll take the stars.
Yeah.
And if you feel like leaving us a 1-star review, go ahead and go fuck yourself. So. But that will do it today. Definitely leave us an iTunes review. Go to Massenomics.com. Go to the store. You can buy some stuff. We have all sorts of cool shirts. We have some new shirts coming out as well, including the Massenomics' Numero Uno tee.
Son of a gun.
And we have three really hot designs piled up next that we're going to be coming out with. So
that is true.
That'll be pretty legit. Also there, if you scroll to the bottom of the page, you can sign up for our email newsletter, which we still have yet to bother anybody with. So if you're worried about us harassing you, it's not going to be too frequently. Facebook.
We have Facebook.
We're there. Tell us about it, Tanner.
We have Facebook.
Go to Facebook.
I don't know if you guys are familiar with Facebook or not, but it's
where people like yell at people that they would normally be nice to.
It's where you're supposed to talk
person.
About politics.
Yeah, I think that's where you do. I promise you this, we're not going to get political on you. It might be funny. It might not be, but
you'll know what's going on in the world of Massenomics.
So like the page if you haven't.
For sure like the page. What's wrong with you?
Mm-hmm.
Is that everything? YouTube, you're watching us on YouTube.
Yeah.
Click the subscribe. If you're not watching us on YouTube, go to YouTube, click subscribe. Mm. We do have other videos and such there as well. That'll do it. I'm Tyler. You can find me on Instagram at Tyler F. and Stone. That's Tyler EFFIN Stone. Tommy?
You can find me on Instagram at Tomahawk_D.
And Tanner?
Check me out on Instagram at Massenomics. And I did think of one other thing quick. we just did the mannequin challenge.
We did.
God. Here's the deal. This is 2 weeks delayed, which means the mannequin challenge is probably
so, as
so
you're
fucking
this,
played out.
So the mannequin challenge is dead. But... But
moms
boy,
out there, you might like it right now.
For all you people that are not quite with it, the mannequin challenge is pretty awesome right now. Go it's do like, it with your friends and see what we did.
We just did the Harlem Shake.
But for everyone else.
And the Running Man Challenge.
Yeah, for everyone else, we got on it. We got it over with so we can say we're done.
So at Massenomics on Instagram.
That's right. And that's where you'll find us all doing the Macarena and whatnot.
So, yeah, Macarena.
And hey, all right, next week we're going to juju on the beat.
Yes, hopefully. I leave for Viva Los Mexico. I think that's how you say it.
Is that in Nebraska?
I don't know
or?
What that means. So we're going to be gone all week. Hopefully, if I get back in time, we'll get another episode in for you next week. Otherwise, there might be...
Otherwise, the show's done.
Show's done. I guess we've been canceled.
We did it.
So thanks a lot for listening out there, everybody, and stay strong.
You just heard the Massenomics podcast with your ears. You're welcome. Check us out on Facebook. Find us on Instagram at Massenomics, and make sure you visit Massenomics.com and buy some of that sweet Massenomics gear. From your friends at Massenomics Studio, home of the world's strongest podcast, stay strong.